with the fifth and sixth graders. So he is a second grader, and he placed on the district second place with the fifth and sixth graders yesterday. And so we're proud of Brian. We're proud of all of our kids. We've learned so much. And this was not an easy study. Stephen's been leading the study. It was about Joshua, Judges, and Ruth. All three books of the Bible. I mean, this is one of the most difficult studies we do. And he did a great job. We're so proud of you. And we'll go in 2 weeks to the district quiz. And so we're anxious to see how he does at district quiz. He says at district quiz, he's going to be first place. So he says he's going to study hard and get first place. So we're glad that he loves the Bible. And these kids, they learn so much about Scripture. So we want to encourage them. Would you stand this morning and greet one another?
It's a privilege to serve, and I'm the Sunday school, and I'm the SDMI superintendent this past year. Just wanted to say a couple things. We averaged 125 with 150 on responsibility list. That's what it is. But SDMI includes a lot more than Sunday school, as you all know. We consist of the life groups, the actual Sunday school classes, the walk, the ladies' night out, our services on Wednesday night. So all that together is what SDMI consists of. And there's really a lot more, but I don't have time to get into it. So anyway, I just want to say I love you, and I have enjoyed serving in SDMI. And at this point, I'll give it over to Karen.
Amen. Thank you.
Good morning. I was the church board member who was the head of the discipleship team. So me and LaWanna and Beverly worked together quite a bit this year, and I found that to be a real privilege to work with them. You can see my kind of summary of the year is in the little packet, so I won't read that to you, but I did want to say, you know, what a blessing it's been to be a part of the discipleship team, and of course, you know, discipleship being at the core of what we do, because we're all learning and growing. We should all be discipling others and sharing what we know, and being discipled ourselves by people who know more, or just by other people as we come together. We all grow in Christ, and that's what matters. And I am going to take my chance to say just a couple things before on this last day. You all are such a blessing to me, and I have just truly been blessed by this church and by the people here. And when it comes to discipleship, I want to say a couple things. Sunday school is a really wonderful time for us to learn and grow and to get intimate with each other and to really get deeper into the scriptures. So I highly encourage you to join a Sunday school class if you're not already in one. There are several really good choices here. Missions Wednesday night service, Beverly will talk more about, but it's a really awesome time. And it's a time to focus our hearts and our minds on other people in the world and in our local communities. So please, she'll tell us when it is. It's what Wednesday it is. I always forget. What Wednesday it is. First Wednesday. First. Easy to remember. Come on the first Wednesday. And eat dinner before. The last thing I want to mention, and it's really a blessing to have our missions team here with us that's getting ready to go on a trip. Macy McKee is also preparing for a summer trip. And so buy some cookies. Give her some money. Help her really have a good time. It means a lot that our church is sending someone on a trip and to go out and just share the gospel. And as we all learn about sharing the gospel, we become better at doing it. And I'm really proud of her. I think she's going to have a great time. So I love you all. Thanks for letting me serve. We're gonna miss everybody so much.
She's a hard act to follow. By the way, I just want to put a little key in for the cookies that are very, very good. I ordered them and they're wonderful. So order some cookies. I do want to thank you for the privilege of allowing me to serve this year as your missions president. We achieved the following goals and took offerings for the following emphasis: for the missionary healthcare, for World Mission Broadcast, International Ministries, Bible and Seminaries, Links Missionaries, I can't talk, Alabaster, Compassionate Ministries, Nails Club, World Evangelism, including Thanksgiving and Easter. And I just want to say that we were able to send in the Kids Project, the Youth Project, and we were able to do 4 memorial rolls. And we were able to send cash Christmas gifts to our Links Missionary, 9 adults, and the 6 children. We sent in crisis care kits and school Pell Packs. And we had the privilege of having Dr. Keith speak. We saved the medicine bottles for Dr. King for his mission trips. And we had a garage sale in August, and I want to thank everybody for participating in that. And we had the privilege of having Steve and Debbie Baker on January 31st. And they were magnificent. They were really interesting, and they kept her attention, and they were funny. And I just want to say a special thanks to the council for Helen Agner, Brian McKee, Susie and Terry Chazak, and also a very special thanks to our pastor, Valerie McKee, Wanda Brazil, Clara Phillips, Annette Peavy, Ronnie and Roshan Arajan, Kiri Dhanarajan, Geraldine Jones, and Andrea Brazil. And I want to thank you for everyone for supporting missions. And if I have missed somebody's name, I apologize. Please forgive me. I just want to say it was a good year this year, and I love you all, and thank you for participating in missions. Thank you.
Amen. What a great time. Hey, I'd like to do this if we could. I'd like to have Dr. Keene to bring your team up front. And we're going to pray for you, and they have a special trip coming up. And then behind that, we're going to have a report from our head of our stewardship team and our treasurer as well, our board secretary. Come on through, just make a line if you like. So good to see you. Come back next week. Amen. No, you be gone, won't you? You be gone.
Beverly.
I know.
Amen.
Hey, don't forget, we have great food today. Wow, you have a great team here. Is this everyone?
Wow.
Yeah, well, hey, tell us where you're going and what you're planning to do, and do they really know the truth about what they're about to get into?
Good morning.
Morning.
During the March time, the spring break, we have 2 teams going down. One's going to the inner part called Veer, and then the other group is going to go with me to Buff Bay. No, they don't know. Some didn't know that about the driving. And the roads.
When he drives, it's, the roads, there's like no guardrails, and the tires go off the side of the dirt, you know?
They don't go off. It's,
well, not quite.
Actually, McKenna's been twice before, so she's brave. So we're going to be going down, I have about 3 other physicians with me, and about 2 nurses and a couple of people. Most of the people here, if it's you folks, and there's one med student, so she's going to kind of practice her wares, what she's learning, and she's of Jamaican heritage, so she's kind of going back home, get back to her people. one of the things that, when we go down there, we leave people back here, especially on these many trips, and so I want you to pray for the folks that we leave as well. While they miss us, and pray for us as we're down there. Anytime you travel to anywhere, there's always a risk inherently. And then when you drive, you're safe. But it's okay. It's other people on the road you have to worry about. But other than that, I want you to pray for us and keep us safe.
Pray
that way.
Thank you so much. I'd like to ask our missions president, Beverly Ramsey, would come and pray for this crew today. We have a great looking crowd here. Amen. Yeah. And, here's what I'd like to invite you to do, if you'd like to join us this way. While we're praying, find someone up here that you will connect with and pray for this coming week. And if you would, you don't have to, but sometimes what people do, they just kind of point a hand towards someone. And just while you bow your head, close your eyes, just point your hand and just pray for that person. And by doing that, letting them know that you'll be praying for them this very week, next week as well. Not just this week, but next week when they actually go. Because that's when it's really important, when it's going to happen. Amen. Would that be okay? Then would you just leave us in a prayer? That'd be okay. Pray for this group.
Should we bow our heads? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the day you've given us. We thank you for the privilege of having Dr. Keene and his team with us. Lord, we pray a special blessing for Dr. Keene. We thank you for his privilege of having him, and we thank you for his dedication and his service, Lord. We pray that you'll be with him, and we pray that you'll give him the knowledge and the understanding of each and every person that he has to treat. And Lord, we just pray for the safety of not only Dr. Keene, but the other doctors and the nurses and the whole team, Lord. We pray for their safety, Lord. We pray for their safety in driving, Lord. We pray for their safety just being in another place that they're not familiar with. We pray that you would take each and every fear away from them, because you're in charge, Lord. And we just thank you, Lord, and we love you, Lord. And we pray a special blessing to each one of them, for each one of them, and we pray for their witness to you, Lord. And we just pray that your hand would be on this team as they go. We pray you'll meet the financial needs, Lord. We pray that you'll give them energy and a way to just handle everything they need to do while they're on their work and witness trip, Lord. And we give you all the honor and the praise and the glory. And we thank you in advance for all you're going to do for each and every one of them. In thy name we pray. Amen.
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 High five. Don't Good job. All right. That was great. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Amen. We have at this time two more reports. And then we'll receive this morning's tithes and offering, and then we have some worship and music as well. So thank you so much for your patience and listening. It's been fun so far, hasn't it? We've been having a good time. It's upbeat. If we could, Rip Purcell is here, and then Valerie McKee will follow.
It's my honor this year to serve as your church board secretary, as well as to head up the stewardship team. As far as our secretary report would be, we had regularly held well-attended meetings with minutes at every meeting, and we had a great board this year. We had a good time getting through some neat projects that you're going to hear more about, so I won't share a lot from other people's reports. As far as stewardship, we have a team that consists of Rick Sandell, Juana Morrow, Beverly Ramsey, and Karen White, and we are tasked with the financial duties and keeping track of finances and such, as well as putting together our budget for the coming year. And I can report to you that we came inside our budget this past year. We have continued our relationship with Christ Classical Academy. We have various other projects going on, and our budget next year has increased just a bit as we step out in faith with projects that we hope that God's leading us toward, and you're going to hear more about those in the other reports as well.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you for allowing me to serve as the church treasurer most days. there's some days it gets a little crazy in there, but our church is so truly blessed, and we have just so many things to be thankful for, and the tithes and the offerings and just so many people beyond that donating their time to do so many projects around here, so we don't have to pay people to do it. We've been able to do some great things this year. As Bill said, I will give you a couple things. If you look at the van, it has been repainted through the Victory Fund that was received this past year. And also, if you walk into the gymnasium now, you notice it is completely quiet. It doesn't buzz anymore because we replaced the lights to be LED lights that are more efficient. And so we have made some great strides this year. All of our allocations for the district and the general treasury are paid. And so we have a faithful God that will provide for us.
Amen. Ooh, well, if we could do this, could we have our ushers come help us for this morning as we receive God's tithes and offerings? You know, some of you may be here today and not understand what this means. A tithe is a tenth of our income that we entrust to God. And we've learned, my wife and I have learned, and many of you have learned as well, for a Christian to trust God, to give Him that tenth. Many times people say, well, it's like dues. It's like being a part of a project or something. You got to do it. No, a tithe is something you want to do. It's not something you have to do. It's something you do out of your love towards God and what He's doing in your life. And we have found, as many of you have, that God can do more with 9/10 in our life than what we can do with 10/10. And so it's like we don't even miss it. And yet God still blesses and takes care of our needs. And there have been times I've had people tell me, oh, I've just been sick all year long. I've been in the hospital and so on. And then I've asked them, I said, well, and they say, well, I haven't really been tithing lately. And I go, well, I'm not asking about it. It's not my responsibility. It's your responsibility with God. So maybe just get back on track with Him. Maybe He'll just touch and heal you. I don't know. God, He has it. If we'll honor Him, He honors us. We just need to honor Him in all things. Amen? So today, I'd just like to pray. And I'd like to say two things. One, Helen Agner's younger brother, Rusty, passed away. And his funeral will be tomorrow in Louisiana. So Helen is gone today. She's traveling today with her kids, I think. And then also yesterday, Stephanie and Tyler were married. And so had a big shindig go on, big great time. It was a fun time to be a part of that. And I even got to pray over the food. But I lost weight and everything. Somebody else, it was cool. They called my name and somebody else prayed. And that was a cool thing. Because I thought, if I could just be that thin again, that would be great. And then also, I wanted to say this. You've been praying for a lot of times and may not realize this, but if you look to the center aisle, a nice, handsome, good-looking man in a wheelchair back there, Sam Kirkland, is here today. He's a new member of this church, and we just give God praise that God is working in Sam's life. Amen?
Amen.
Pray with me, if you would. Father God, we love You so much. We thank You. We're confident in who You are and what You want to do through our lives. You're working with us, and You're teaching us, and You're convicting us and convincing us of our sin and the direction we need to walk within our lives. That, Father, today we just believe without a shadow of a doubt we are here by divine appointment. We're here not by accident. Everything that happens today will be for Your honor and Your glory. Thank You again for Your blessings. Thank You for blessing the gift and the giver. In the name of Jesus, we would pray these things. Amen.
Thank you.
ahead. We're all
good morning, church, and it's so good to see each other here.
Thank you.
I don't know these things either. I'm not a speaker. I'm a worker. And I would like to say that we do have a lot of wonderful people that's helped me with my project this year. And I think it has worked very well. We do need a lot of people, though, to get involved. It blesses you more than it does anyone else. Thank you.
Amen. Praise God. Amen.
And I've been heading the fellowship committee. And knowing Nazarene Church, fellowship and food go very, very closely together. So most anything to do with food comes through our group. And we've had a lot of good volunteers. We've had a lot of donations and a lot of participation. And I thank you all for that. And we can always use more help for cleaning up tables and any, like today.
Amen.
A volunteer after lunch today, we'd love to have your help. So there's always room for help and love to have you cook, whatever. So just see one of us and we'll be glad to put you to work. So praise God for all he's done for us and he continues to do for us.
Amen. Good.
Oh, there you are. I was going to hand you the microphone. Hey, by the way, if I could say real quickly, those of you that are guests today, if you brought a guest, please, you go first today with our seniors. Not calling you a senior adult, but we want you as our guest to go first. And secondly, if you're willing to help put tables away today, you can go first too.
It's been an interesting time for Magnus and for the church. And I want to give a special thanks to Greg Gilbert. He comes twice a week, does a lot of the little things we need done. And this coming year, I think what I'm going to do is have a little more emphasis on work days, especially getting people to come and help. We've had good help in the past, but we need more. We've got lots of things to do around the church that anybody can do. And so I'm going to be asking. And we get these excuses that I'm going to be out of town and all kinds. But anyway, I'm glad that you're all here and we'll be seeing more of you. Thank you.
And I'm in charge of the worship. What happens in the service stays in the... No, I'm just kidding. Anyway, it's been an honor and a privilege to represent the worship committee. And I am very thankful for the committee because if it weren't for them, we would not have a very decent worship service. It would be frazzled. Anyway, thank you all very much. And those that were on the drama team this year, the choir, all those, what a wonderful, tremendous group to work with. And if you need to let your voice ring out, please come join us. We would love to have you. And we also are in charge of the communion and the baptismal and things like that. And if you, I tell you what, you really miss a blessing if you don't volunteer to help put them in and take them out because you get to see their face before and after. It's wonderful. So please volunteer. And on a personal note, I'd like to really thank you all. It's been a rough year. I lost my dad in the summer, and I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for allowing me to be part of your family. You know, without parents, you kind of feel lost and orphaned, so it's great to have friends, and it's great to have family, and I love you guys so much. Thank you.
We have a gentleman from Come and Share. He's been our family pastor of kids, and Pastor Ashok is going to come and share. Today's their last Sunday, and we'll talk more about that in a moment, but here you go, brother. You can really get on to them now, all right?
Woo! So,
thank you. I just want to thank everyone who's gone before me today, being really short, because I got about 30 minutes sermon to prepare. Now, my pastor's report is in the, this is especially for Betsy. I'm going to get her saved today. My pastor's report is in your booklet that you've got, and so I won't go over all the details there, but I do want to thank you. This is my fourth pastor's report that I get to give as your family pastor of kids, and it's also my last, and so it's a little bit bittersweet, but I'm so thankful for this opportunity that I've had to be a part of the TFC family. And I just want to say this year has been a harder year in ministry than I've had in any other time in ministry. And I think I kept expecting God to continue to grow our children's group as he has been. We've seen incredible gains, but I think God reminded me this year is when you reach out, there's more than just numbers that happen. And kids come to your ministry and they've got challenges in their lives. And so there's a time of deepening and growing in their walk that you've got to be a part of. And we've seen some tough things that our kids go through this year. But I'm so thankful for God to lead us faithfully and for a church family that has rallied around these families and been able to support them through some difficult times. So we may not have grown numerically this year as I'd like to have seen, but we have definitely grown deeper in our walk with Christ. Of course, that all couldn't happen without some great volunteers, and those are all listed in the booklet as well. But I want to especially thank a few people this year. I want to thank William Kreitz, who is one of our four state students. He races here on Wednesday nights after full day of classes, and maybe organic chemistry is your last one or something going on there. And so he comes here, and immediately we jump on the van, and we go pick up kids, and we've been picking up these last few weeks, plus the 13, 15 kids. That's not just kids, but that's teenagers also, so we're starting to connect to a broader group. And so thank you, William, for being there. Of course, Stephen for Wednesday nights, who's taking the lead on a lot of things, so thank you, Stephen. You guys provide excellent care, and it's something that I trust you guys completely with my two kids, so thank you for that as well. But I also want to thank Annette, Karen, Deb. On Wednesday nights, I start picking up kids, leave at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. By the time we drop off, and I'd get home, it'd be after 10:30 at night. And that's hard. And I like to see my kids too, but they have stepped up and they have taken kids home. They've worked it out. I'll just tell Annette how many kids I have, I need rides home, and she'll work that out, get them rides home. So that has been a tremendous blessing. And they have grown to love Karen, Deb, and Annette also. So I think that's a wonderful thing too. They've been able to be with them and build relationships there. And I also want to thank Patricia. She has tirelessly helped bring kids going through car troubles, going through all sorts of things, but she has always been there and happy to take home. And she is willing and always does it with a joyful spirit. So thank you, Patricia, for doing that, for helping out with rides as well. So some of the highlights from this past year include we took 15 children to our district kids camp, and 11 of those were first-time campers. So that's an amazing thing. We had a tremendous week. We joined with over 300 other kids from across our district, and we had an incredible week. And so that's coming up soon. So help these kids get there again. I'd appreciate it. We've got a good opportunity for them to learn about Christ for an entire week and to be influenced by some incredible people. Same thing is we gave estimated 200 school supply bags to children through our back-to-school drive that happened on August 1st. This was our second annual back-to-school drive. And you guys came through so much with donations that we had more donations than we had kids show up to our event and families. So what we were able to do is we were able to resource teachers at Hartsfield and Bond Elementary with school supplies as well. We also have, throughout the year, since we have some resources, they're able to come back. If they call, we're able to resource kids on an ongoing basis, which is an incredible thing. Number three, we implemented children's and volunteer check-in and check-out policy systems. That's another way we're making our kids' programs safe for TFC. We redesigned our fall festival with carnival games, bounce houses, chili cook-off, and pie bake-off, and we did it on a different night than Halloween, and we saw an incredible amount of people come through. I don't know the exact numbers, but it was in the hundreds. 200 to 300 people came through. It was packed in our gym for several hours, and so we had a good time, so thank you all for that. And we had a children's musical, Dude, You Hear What I Hear. We had 17 of our K-Rock kids involved with that. They did an incredible job. This was our hardest musical we've done yet. They will tell you that. There was a lot of yelling, a lot of screaming, a lot of crying, and I'm over that now. I've gotten better. Therapy and prayers. Kids loved it. They did a great job again, and so I just amazed every year at their talent and their willingness to serve, and so I hope you guys enjoy that ministry as well. And then, lastly, this is probably one of the coolest things I've done in ministry. On February 7th, baptized 7 of our K-Rock kids, and that was a tremendous blessing because I know that they were sincere, and we've been talking for a long time, and they made the decisions themselves, and I didn't pressure or anything, and so I'm so thankful for that. You'll also see in your pamphlet, there's four goals, which I won't read through, but you'll see the goals I had for this past year, how we met those goals, and where we need to improve. So again, this was a tough year, ministry-wise, but one that has been stretching me and blessing me through God's grace and what He can do when we get out of the way and allow Him to lead. And so that's kind of my report, and thank you for allowing me to serve. And I just want to say, as our last Sunday here, as part of the TFC family, I shouldn't say it that way, I'll always be a part of the TFC family. I was raised here, and people here have changed my diapers, and I don't know, I guess maybe I'll retire here, and some of you might change my diapers again. But I just want to thank you. This, no matter where I go, I want you guys to know that this is always my home. And I remember as a senior in high school, at a revival, Pastor Scott Ostendorf, who went home to be with the Lord, challenged us, and I remember standing over there and sharing with the congregation that God has called me into ministry full time. And at that point, I didn't know what that would look like, where that would lead me. All I knew is that I was going to say yes, and wherever that is, and whenever that is, I would go. And so for a time, He's allowed me to come back to Tallahassee First Church of Nazarene to be your children's pastor, and it's been a tremendous blessing. Never thought I would be in children's ministry, but God has opened my eyes to the wonderful gift that is our kids. And I just want to challenge you as we leave, as we go take on this new position as a lead pastor at Lake City Church of Nazarene, I want to challenge you guys. This is great what we do here. I love coming here on Sundays and worshiping. But God's story is a lot bigger than what happens in this sanctuary. It is part of God's story. And God's story has been happening way before you were born. It's going to continue way after you were born.
Right.
And He has called you to serve Him and to participate in His work. It is a privilege beyond what I can ever begin to describe. So I want to challenge each of you here on my last day. I want you to grab a hold of the vision God has placed on you, because God's word says that each of you has been gifted with grace, graces and talents and gifts that only come from Christ Jesus, and they only work when we all work together for building up the body of Christ. If you're merely showing up here, you're not doing what God has called you to do. And the body is suffering. And you are suffering. But if you want to grab a hold of everything God that has for you, you need to start letting go and surrendering everything to Him. And I promise you, it's the most out of control feeling you'll ever have in your life. But the good thing is that God has taken control, and there's only one person who is truly in control, and that is God. And that is who we serve. And so God is bigger than these things that we're trying to do. We're playing a small part in that. But He has a plan for you, and He's gifted you, and He will provide, no matter where He leads you and what He does. I want you guys to grab a hold of that. I want to challenge you, because we have a community and we live in a city that is desperate to hear the word of God. And God said that you are not to be a light, to be hidden. But God has placed His light in each and every one of us. So shine brightly. Continue to minister. Do the hard things. Roll up your sleeves and work, because it's for God's glory. And I promise you, you'll be blessed beyond measure when you allow Him to use your life as He intended to use it.
Hey, could you bring your bride for a moment? I don't know if your kiddos, they might be in the nursery, but is that okay? Can we get them? We've, that's a sad day for us, too. But we have it for you. And I'll try to get all the blubbers out before Carrie gets back, but no. It's been a great joy of knowing that so many things we could do, it's not by yourself. We're all connected. And in something like this, an annual meeting, so many times there are things that people will kind of flick off and turn the channel off. But everything that's been said today is for everyone's here. I mean, it doesn't matter if you're a member of this church or not. It's for every person who's breathing in this room as well. Everything that's going on, God is doing for you on your behalf. And He uses imperfect people in an imperfect church who has lots of flaws and problems and difficulties and have all kinds of things that go on in their lives. and they have financial failures, and they have relational failures, and divorces, and things go on. But God is trying to get a hold of each and every one of us, as the show was saying. But if each of us would comply and just kind of do what He wants for us, He'll work out incredible things within each and everyone's life. He has a home set, it's called heaven, just for you. And it doesn't just happen because you think of it. Too many people today think they're Christian because it's in their head, but they never open up their heart to Jesus Christ. And until you open up your heart to Jesus Christ and that, amen, you'll be on a road of heathenism, as Ashok was one day. He'll tell you. His life, he'll tell you, he had a life of kind of a worldliness, even though he was raised in a church home. But yet God got a hold of him. And how God will not only change his life, but God can change your life as well. So Ashok and Carrie and
Mr. Caleb, good to see you, man.
Miss Faye,
we love you. You're so cute. We have a little token of our appreciation on behalf of the church, and you're welcome to open it if you like. It's so pretty, but maybe you can see what it is. But we might. Can you help me?
Okay.
You want to help open it? We just want to say thank you so much for the time you invested with us. Almost a 4-year period of time. June would be 4 years. I never thought that someone who was a youth pastor would come in and do such an incredible job as a children's pastor. But God had a plan years ago. And when I approached them about this, they thought, but I do youth ministry. But God's done something different. And even on our district, our church district, Pastor Ashok is over all the children's ministries as well. So that's an incredible thing and insight to know what God's doing in your life. So, yeah.
It just says Tallahassee First Church, February 28th, 2016, and it's got our logo for TFCN on it. Home church, so thank you guys.
Hey, we love you, Carrie. I know you both are possible. Is there anything you'd like to share here in thought? I mean, any last moment things of take your trash?
I think the thing that I would like to share in addition is, you know, we came here when Caleb was 6 weeks old and started our journey here. And so you guys will always be the place where he grew up from a baby to a boy. And of course, we have Veda in the midst of that too, and that she has gone now from a baby to a little girl. And everything you've invested in them and to help them grow into the kids that they're becoming has meant so much. And I know they've been loved just so deeply, and that we've been loved so much, and I mean that has meant more than I can express or say, and I thank you for that. I thank you that we've gained lifelong friends here, and I fully expect you to stay on Facebook and chat with me or call me or text me, or just when we come to visit, we want to see you. We love you, and take care of Mom and Dad.
Amen.
They're heartbroken, so be with them. No, I'm just kidding. We do appreciate your love for them too.
Thank you guys again, and thank you for this wonderful gift that we'll proudly display when we're out in Lake City. And as Carrie said, pray for us as we step into this new season of ministry. We understand that we're completely overwhelmed and unprepared, but God will prepare us, and He'll be faithful, and He will provide what we need to get His will done. So we're looking forward to that. And pray for us too. We're really close to Gainesville, and there's people everywhere. The migraines set in, so no, Esther, no, this is not good. So pray for us as we continue to convert. We'll continue to convert them to Garnet Gold.
Can we just get a quick picture? Do you don't mind, do you? Just a quick picture. Just going to come stand in front of me because I'm fat. We want a picture of you. We want to see your happy face. Make those people out there laugh. That's it.
Bye. Well, we thought we were singing again.
Okay, let's sing a song.
You ready? Stand with us this morning.
God Almighty, honey, you're the church. You are the church. So wherever you go, that's where the church is. So when you're in the presence of other people and they're telling jokes and things that are anti-God, anti-Christ, do you have an influence against them? Do they understand who you are, or do they just see you as someone melting and blending in? And so as I want to share a report with you, it's also kind of a message that God has laid, so somehow it's kind of woven together. So some of it I'm reading and some of it I'm not, so I'd ask that you to listen to what's going to happen. I don't know what it means. I'm just trying to understand what God's wanting to do in the life of this church. And maybe as you have already heard, we have an incredible team. We have an incredible team of servant leaders. And our preparations are now to go forward as we begin this new church year. It starts on March the 1st. I'm overwhelmed for everyone's participation for this quest of Christ, that as we continue to go out and reach the lost. I thank our church board leadership and their ministry action teams. I appreciate Annette Peavy and her worship arts team and all those who have helped, and our team ministers this past year, Ken and Donna Nichols. And then now, Reverend Dennis Gavin, who will be taking over as a pastoral service, doing part-time ministry here as well. My gratefulness goes on to a lady who wraps packages and keeps me out of trouble a lot, and that's my incredible, supportive wife. She has been with me for over 40 years and has put up with a lot. Amen, she said.
We should just close church right now. Our very able assistant, the ministry assistant in the church office, Valerie McKee. Thank you, Valerie, for so many things that you do and keep us out of trouble. It's such a nice thing. And then there's accidental times you can miss someone. You try to group them in generalities sometimes, but there's one, as we've already talked about and shared, that I've learned to grow and to dream and to pray and to trust God with, and that's Ashok Dhanarajan. Yes, I'm sad that he and his family are leaving, but I praise God that he's listening and answering to God's call, and he'll become the new lead pastor of our Lake City Church. So they're getting an incredible quality, high-quality family. And they're coming from Tallahassee first. Amen? So we have kind of an investment in Lake City too. So we'll just be praying that God will use you in an incredible way. We hope that you just blow the doors off and the windows, and there'll be an incredible ministry for you over there as well. His kids associate, Stephen Powell, will have directorship beginning tomorrow officially, effectively. I almost said dictatorship. That's what I'm getting at. Hey, at Tallahassee First, we're a church of the Nazarene. There are three words that describe us. We're Christian, meaning that we believe that you have to surrender to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. We're missional. We go out and do what Jesus did. Go out and seek and to save those which are lost. To do whatever it takes to reach them for Him. And third, we're holiness, meaning we're not just saved, but there's a work of grace. It's the same salvation of God, but it's a sanctification where He comes in and sets us apart to do His service, His ministry, whatever He calls us to do. We are gladly doing it without any question, both palms down. In the year 2016 and 17, projects to be one of our finest years ever. Tallahassee First has been blessed by the Lord to have become an equipping center. For some reason, it's been happening over the past few years of time. We seemingly have people that after about 2 years of time, they pick up and they move to Florida, some other place, or they go to some other part of the United States, and they start serving the Lord there. And then the Lord graciously brings new people in, and we're able to create relationships, and they're here for 2, maybe 3 years of time, and then they go someplace else. And it's like we can't seem to break a big number. But for whatever reason, we're like, need to understand, this is the Lord's church. It's not my church, it's not your church, it's His church, and He's going to construct what He wants through us, and He sees gifts and graces in us that we can't even see within ourselves. When Simon Peter one day often didn't know where his next step was heading, Jesus told him, He said, "Upon this rock I will build my church." Another name for Simon Peter was blockhead. Sometimes the church, we're like Simon Peter. We have a great voice, but we have little action. But later, his life became a great event of action. The Church of Jesus Christ holds somewhat of a similar example of a sporting team. Each team hosts a leader of leaders, and each are called to perform at the highest level of example and expectation. When each player prepares mentally, emotionally, spiritually for the battle that's set before each game, success will arise. The team focus is simply one game at a time. For the church, our biggest game of the year is Easter. And the question I would pose to you is, what would happen with all the efforts that we tend to make for Easter time if we saw every Sunday as important as Easter, and that we would reach out? In other words, what would happen, because we tend to have many people who come to the doors, through the doors of the church on Easter Sunday. And let's say, for example, if you had on average 30 to 50 people who come on any given Lord's Day Sunday for Easter, and we're able to retain possibly, say, 10 of those, think of what would happen if we could do that every week and see 10 new people that we were able to retain for the glory of God, that they're able to assimilate and work and become a part of a living body here of Christ over a 52-week period of the year. You do the math. It's an incredible and exciting number to know that 520 people could actually start doing other ministries. You can't stop the very fact of the vision of what God is wanting to do. The Bible says in order for that to happen, Zechariah 4:6 reminds us, it's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by my spirit, says the Lord. There's some goals, I believe, that God has given to us to reach. And as you look today, you say, I don't know if we can do that. The things that we try to do on our own, we can't do. But with the Lord, nothing will be impossible. Amen?
Amen.
We're envisioning that God has laid upon our heart seeing 52 people one to the Lord this coming year, at least 52. Think about that, 52 brand new people, people who have never been a Christian before. The world, our city is full of people who need the touch and the love of Jesus Christ. Amen? You know who they are. New members of the church, we could grow up to as many as at least 20 people, 26 more baptisms, a worship service that we average a minimum of 158 to 160. That's not a lot of people. I've asked the Lord to give us to 200, 250. I've been praying for a church of 1,000. But until, like what we had talked about earlier, until some basic mechanics happen and we just surrender fully to Him, we just kind of keep going through the things that we've always been comfortable with. So remember three words I give you. Save, equip, and serve. When you do what God wants you to do, He'll help save people. He'll take care of that. And we will equip them, we'll train them to send them out to serve the King of Kings. So in order to have the hand of the Holy Spirit of God to overshadow this body of believers, at least four little steps need to happen. Number one, first, we need to establish a sense of urgency. John Cotter of Harvard says that if change is not considered necessary, people will find 1,000 ingenious ways to withhold cooperation. One of the keys to change is passion. We do what we want to do. If one doesn't seem to care, one will not bother to care. Our sense of urgency must also occur on an emotional level. The Bible reminds us in Romans 12, 2, that we need to be transformed through the renewing of our mind. Be willing to learn new things. So whatever our change must be, it must be urgent. And for example, if you or I wanted to add another worship service, say on a Friday or Saturday evening, who in their right mind would want to give up time to go start a service for worship of people who, those folks who tend to work on Sunday mornings and they can't be here during a regular service time, who in their right mind would ever want to go and just volunteer to come out on a Friday or a Saturday evening, you know? And to have a church service? So that people could be presented with the truth of Jesus Christ and the love of Christ in their lives? Well, I believe that's what some of the things that God's wanting us to consider as well. The Bible declares that each one of us will stand before God and give an account for this generation of non-Christians. We must not simply embrace change, but we need to cry out for it. Next, we need to develop and cast our compelling vision. Where will this change take place? Where will it take us? How will it come about? Vision is simply painting a picture of what direction that God wants this church to go. And when each of us involved believers start seeing that our purpose is to make Christ-like disciples in the nations, beginning in Tallahassee, it'll start flashing over within our church board meetings. It'll happen within our Sunday school classes. It'll happen in life groups. It'll happen in worship services. It'll happen in anything and everything that the church puts its hands on to do. We cannot over-communicate God's vision. Another step is to begin our implementation of His plan. So in other words, we need to be able today, the church needs to be working a system that works. For example, if you take the word system, here's maybe a good way to remember it. Saves you stress, time, energy, and money. As change agents, when leaders hurry to implement changes with people not committed to change, well, you know what's going to happen. Frustration occurs, and probable necessary change does not occur. Here at Tallahassee First, we have different people with different character, different backgrounds of understanding, but all coming under one sovereign grace of God. And through a prayerful determination, God will mold all of our teams together as we march together, as we push together until something happens, until prayer, we see the hand of God starting to change things. Listen, we all have Red Sea moments. We all have times where we are standing and faced with a crisis. But we have to understand that either we're going to give in to fear or we'll surrender to faith. And if we'll surrender to faith, we'll follow the leadership of God's Holy Spirit, for the promised land will then just be right in sight. Amen. So we also need to finally restate the vision. Now listen to this one. When restating the vision, it will encourage the church body, similar to something that's called the Nehemiah Principle. In the book of Nehemiah, there was something that had occurred, and in chapter 4, in that passage, what was going on is that they needed to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. It had been torn down and battled, and Ezra comes back, the prophet, and then Nehemiah is given the chore to rebuild it. Well, what a big task it was to rebuild the walls. Well, the Bible says that it took them 52 days, but midway, about 26 days, they started grumbling and complaining because they forgot what they were doing it for. They were just like most church people. They see all labor, and they get tired, and they start thinking of themselves rather than thinking of the vision that God has for them. So Nehemiah, the principle was, he revisited the vision for them to help them see that it was something and for someone greater of a cause than what they were doing. For example, a sideline note, the folks who are going on this trip to Cameo may not see it as for what it truly may be, but once you get there and complete your mission, you'll see that there'll be a blessing greater than one that you just signed up for. Maybe you think you're going down for the beach and having a lot of great times, but seeing people's lives changed forever, what an incredible blessing and what a privilege that you have an opportunity to be a part of. The Bible says in Proverbs 29, verse 18, if people cannot see what God is doing, they stumble all over themselves. Theodore Roosevelt one time said, it's not the critic who counts, not the man who points out what the strong man has stumbled or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the person who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes up short again and again, who knows the great enthusiasm and the great devotions, and spends himself in a worthy cause, who at best knows in the end triumph of a high achievement, and who at the worst, if they fail, at least fails daring doing something greatly, so that his or her place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who knew neither victory nor defeat. I read once about one of possibly the greatest basketball player who's ever played the game, Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan would practice for 45 minutes before each and every game because he felt that there was some facet in his game that needed to be improved. And no one made that determination for Jordan but himself. But maybe that was why he had the type of the determination that when he entered the floor and on the court, other players knew he came to play and he was ready to go. That led him to make an incredible impact on every court that he played on. That's what needs to happen through Tallahassee First Church. We need to recapture the same attitude. We need to be willing to step up to the plate, get in the game of life, need to help others for the sake of eternity. The church, this church, is the hope of our world. And unless we rethink our processes, and more importantly, our attitude, we will lose this generation for Christ. Jesus will one day return for his church, for you and me. He has no other plan to reach the lost except through the church. I would rather attempt to do something great for God and fail than to attempt to do nothing and succeed. Join with me. Pray with me. Serve with me. Allow the holiest Spirit of God to fully cleanse your hearts and your minds. And let's go and depopulate hell with the good news of Jesus Christ and of his kingdom. There shall be no end. This is our time to serve. This is our time to serve. In Jesus' name, amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Well, I just know one person doesn't do it. That's why it's called a church family. Amen? Well, God bless you today. I'm so grateful that you're able to be here. I would invite you, though. I would invite you this very second. I want to give you some ballot results, if you don't mind. And thank you for your patience. But I want to say to you, my friends, today, Is Jesus in your heart? It goes like this. In fact, if I would invite every one of you just to pray a prayer with me like this. Say, Lord Jesus, I know I have sin in my life. I repent of it. And I want you to come and live inside of me. And I want to do your will. And from this moment on, I'm yours. Whatever you want from me, I'm willing to do the best I know how. Thank you for forgiving me. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, if you prayed that, it's your area of faith, your trust, your belief of knowing that God, by the power of faith, so many times we've made salvation so hard, but God wants it to be so easy. God doesn't want anyone to perish. He wants everyone to come to everlasting life. He doesn't want any of you to miss it. He wants to be involved in every one of your lives. Amen? And He wants you to be the church. Amen? Because Jesus will come back for you one day. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Just real quickly. Looks like these, if I have the right paper here, these are the ones that you have elected. I don't have the sheet that tells everyone's votes. I just have the sheet that tells, it looks like the ones who were elected. For the church board, you've elected Suzette Dalton, 28, Rajdon Rajan, 42, Deb Elliott, 28, Stephen Powell, 25, Bill Purcell, 41, Karen White, 34, for NMI president, Beverly Ramsey, 50, Bonnie Rebel, 46, and for the delegates for the district assembly, you have Helen Agner. I'll just read these out for you. Helen Agner, Wanda Brazell, Rajdana Rajan, Geraldine Jones, Brian McKee, Valerie McKee, Nita Pullen. We have an election. There's no ties. Praise God. Hallelujah. Sometimes that takes a long time. Amen. There's a little song that says this. And I'd like to invite those on the platform to come down and those on the floor to stand. I'm going to come down here. And won't you stand with me for a moment? Would you do that? I'm going to turn my microphone off in just a moment, but we want to give God thanks. Father, for this luncheon, this time together, this meeting, for every soul that's here today, you have accomplished a purpose, and we thank you so much for everyone's patience and their persistence and their newfound passion to serve the risen Savior. Oh Lord, make us one. Make us one in your bond of love, even this very day. In the name of Jesus, we pray these things. Amen? Amen. Could you find someone and hold a hand? I'm going to turn this off here so I'm not. Let's face this way if we can. If you're on the platform, come on down. Come on down. Don't want anyone playing the piano or drums or sound equipment. Come on down, Andrea. Come join us. Reach across the aisle if you would. How about that? Reach, come, just come on across. Amen. It's okay. Hey, I don't know them. Oh, that's okay. We have soap and water and... Amen. Praise God. I believe whatever God blesses, He cleanses. Amen. Here's a little song. You may not know this, but if you and I are going to make it into heaven, we need to be one. Here's how the song goes. Join me if you know it.
We are one in the pond of love. We are one in the pond of love. Spirit of God, we are one in the bond of love. We are one in the bond of love. We are one in the bond of love. We have joined our spirits with the Spirit of God. We are one in the bond of love.
Today, say amen. Give God praise today. Amen. I'd like to invite a show for Terry and their family, his parents, and all of our guests to go at this time. We can't eat until you go, so won't you pass someone through? Amen. God bless you today.